Okay, let's continue with this Bayesian approach to parameter estimation. Applied to the normal distribution. I didn't do this already, did I? Okay. Seems hauntingly familiar. But maybe because of a year ago or something. I dreamt about it, yeah, that's it. I dreamt that I gave this lecture already. Okay, so case one. So we have a normal density. We're going to write one over sigma squared as the Greek letter C. Now, before I said C when I wrote something else, but I was wrong. This one is C. That one was, that's Zeta, like Catherine Zeta-Jones, the actress. Okay. It's her. Her name is Joan. It'd be more easily written this way, Zeta Jones. Okay, so we'll use C for 1 over sigma squared. One advantage of this is you don't have to write so many symbols, right? For this, you have to write a 1, a horizontal line, and a sigma, and it's 2. Here you just have to write one thing. And that's always good. But also, this has a special name. This is called the precision. If this is big, what does that mean? A big precision means how can you get this to be big? What has happened here? This has to be small. Variance is small. Okay, and we think of small variance as being giving rise to some precision. So we'll call that the precision. And then we can write the density this way. Okay. Is that right with everyone? You look unhappy. Is that okay? Is it okay? Okay. It's too hard to draw. Okay. All right. Okay, so in case one, we're going to assume that theta is unknown. But theta is known. Or C is known, sorry. And we're going to try to estimate. So we want to estimate theta, and we give theta a prior distribution of normal. Thank you. Oh, that's an oversight, sorry. Thank you. I forgot to put the mean in. Okay. So initially, we'll assume that the mean is a random variable. Which is normal with some mean and some variance sigma z prior to the minus 2. Okay. So we're specifying the mean and the precision for the random variable, which will give the theta. And then given some data or some observations, we want to come up with a new distribution for theta. That's called the posterior. So the prior density for theta looks like this. Yeah.
Is it just negative?
Yeah, because what's the relation? How could we express to the minus 1, thank you. Minus 1. Minus 1. Because 1 over the precision is the variance. Yeah, thanks. So zeta to minus 1 here. Okay. So the density, or the probability of having this outcome, is this here. Okay, and what we're interested in is the density of theta, the random variable theta, given the observation.
What happened to the 2 and 1/2?
Okay, so this is just the product of these things evaluated at the different xi's. So we get this thing to the power n. And then since we have an exponential, a product of exponentials becomes the exponential of the sum here. Okay. This means it's proportional to where the constant of proportionality does not depend on theta. So why is that? This thing would be equal to let's see if I have this right. I think I have to have slashes here, right? Let's see if I get this right. Yeah. This is more or less the definition of conditional density. This conditional density would be the joint divided by this marginal. What would this one be? Would be the joint divided by this marginal. And now use this line up here for the numerator. It's supposed to be capital theta there. Okay, so here's what we want. And it's given by this, a conditional density times the theta marginal over the marginal for x. But what does this symbol mean? It means that everything's here except some constant that doesn't depend on theta. What constant is it? It's this. Okay, this doesn't depend on theta, so I don't include it in here. Why don't I include it in there? Because it can be recovered later by recognizing the vegetable patty part of the density. And then you know what the constant has to be, so you can just put in the right constant later. You don't have to keep track of it. How do you pick the right constant? It's the one that makes the integral equal to 1. Okay, so is that okay with everybody? This constant means there's some constant missing here, but that constant it doesn't depend on theta. So it should be, the right-hand side should be this. But I'm only keeping the stuff that depends on theta, which is in the numerator. And I can ignore the denominator for now. It's a constant. It doesn't depend on theta, and that's what this means. Good? OK, now the fun begins. We write down what these things are. We wrote this down in the middle board here. And And then this we take to be another normal. Like that. Okay. So there's the marginal for theta. Here's the conditional density of the x's given theta. And I multiply those together. And now let's combine the things out in front. But I'm just going to write those as a constant. So maybe I'll use this notation here again. Let's forget about those for now. I'm more interested in the theta parts. So I'm just going to throw these out and say that this thing is proportional to what I'm going to write down now, and the constant of proportionality does not depend on theta. So I'm not going to write those again. That's a lot of symbols to write. And if I do that, I don't have to write them. So what's left is just a product of two exponentials. And what are we interested in? We're interested in the theta part here. And what does it look like? What function of theta is in the exponent? What kind of function is that? It's a polynomial in theta of what degree? What's the highest degree of theta, highest power on theta here? Theta squared is a polynomial of degree 2. And when you have a polynomial of degree 2 in an exponent in a density, what kind of thing do you usually get? Or do we normally see? What kind of things do we normally see? Normal. Okay, this should be normal. Do you like my didactic techniques leading you to the right conclusion? Oh, I have another board here. Okay, so what should we do to discover what this is? What does a normal look like? It's got a something here minus something, right? This is the variable, and then minus the mean. So somehow we should try to recombine this stuff. So I think that means we should kind of take that stuff out of the exponent for now and then shake it up and see what happens. So let's expand everything. So first of all, when I multiply this out, I get this squared minus twice the product plus that squared. When I sum this squared, I get sum I equal 1 to n xi squared. Then I get minus zeta theta sum I equal 1 to n xi. And then I get plus n zeta theta squared over 2. Is that correct? Because for the last term, I have theta squared. I'm adding it up n times, so I get n theta squared. And then I have to multiply by this. It's okay so far. And then here, we get plus zeta prior over 2 theta squared minus zeta prior theta theta naught theta, and then plus zeta prior, oh, I keep saying zeta, c prior, over 2 theta naught squared. And we're interested in the theta bit of this, so let's combine the theta squared terms. That's this and this. Let's combine the theta terms. That would be here and here. I'm going to write this as C times X N X bar, and here I have C prior theta naught, all that's times theta plus some constant, meaning it doesn't depend on theta. Now I'm going to factor out this part. Okay, all is not lost. Don't give up hope. Now what? Yeah, there's something missing here. You can see there's space, right? What should it be? How do you complete the square? Right, divide this by 2 and square it. And I don't have to write it down, because you all know it. So what do we get in the end? NC, but C prior over 2. And then theta minus something, NC X bar, plus C prior, over NC plus C prior, quantity squared, plus some constant. Stuff that doesn't depend on theta. When I complete the square here, that's the this part becomes theta minus this thing squared. And then I have a constant from before, but when I complete the square, it does what? That introduces another constant. The thing I'm adding here doesn't depend on theta, so it's still another constant. So if I substitute that back in here, I get that my conditional density of capital theta given capital X of little theta given the vector of observations little x is proportional to exponential minus nc plus c prior over 2 times theta minus nc x bar plus c prior over nc plus c prior squared. Okay, all the other stuff is some constant, and that constant has to serve to make this thing integrate to 1 in theta. So what does that constant have to be? Well, if this is the non-constant part of the density, what kind of density are we looking at? Normal with mean here and this as its precision. Yeah, or 1 over, that's 1 over the variance. So the constant has to be the precision over 2 pi. And then we get e to this stuff. Okay, and this is why I didn't keep track of the constants, because in the end it has a very simple form. I can just write it down because I know what it takes to make this thing integrate to 1. I could have kept track of it all along the way, but being a person who likes to do things that are simpler rather than harder, I did this. Okay, so what's the posterior distribution of capital theta given the observation little x1 through little xn?
Normal.
It's normal?
Yeah.
Yeah? Right. Okay, normal with this mean, that variance. So as n gets larger, if n is big, how much influence does the prior parameters play in here? Well, it looks like the theta naught is lost. Or was it? No? Did I make a... I forgot to put theta naught here. Yeah, theta naught, I forgot to record it from here to here. So... that should be
everywhere.
Yeah, this should be where? Here?
Yeah.
Here. And here. And here. And where?
Over.
Here. Sorry about that. Okay, theta naught. Forgot to record it from this line to this line. See, prior was multiplied by theta naught. Goes to here. Okay, so insert that in everywhere. So here's the old mean, but if n is large, this term and this term don't play much role. Right? You can see that by dividing top and bottom by n. You get c times x bar, and this would be divided by n, that would be divided by n. And also here you can see that this dominates the prior precision. Okay, so that information about the prior, or the influence of the prior, gets wiped out or doesn't play a big role when you have a large sample. Okay. So the nice thing here about the assumption that the prior distribution of theta is normal is that the posterior distribution of theta is also normal, stays in the same class. Okay, we started with a normal prior distribution. We wound up with a normal posterior distribution. Okay, well, that was case one. Let's do case two. Case one was the precision was known, but the mean was unknown. This time, theta will be known, and C is unknown. So we want to come up with And just like in this case up here, replacing theta with C, see the top line up there? There's a constant missing here. What would it be? We should divide this by the marginal of x, but the marginal of x doesn't depend on the variable c, so I don't write it. Okay, and now this guy we know. Remember here, theta is a known quantity. And then we have to multiply by the density for the parameter, which we're trying to estimate. So in rough outline, what kind of function of C is this? This looks like what? We have a constant, of course. We have C to a power. What power? N over 2. And then we have e to the minus nu times C, where nu is what? Half the sum I equal 1 to n xi minus theta squared. Right? Yeah. What does that look like? Looks like gamma, right? If I do this, then that's the gamma density, right? So how should we choose this if we are trying to avoid a lot of work? Uniform, maybe. If we chose it to be gamma also, what form would it have? It would have this to a power, and it would have e to something times c. What happens when you multiply two of those together? You get c to another power, just the sum of the powers, and you get e to another constant times c, where the constant is the one from here plus the one you get from there. So if we take the prior distribution to be gamma, then the posterior distribution will also be gamma. So let's do that. Maybe I should do, can I do this, change in your notes mu, because I'm going to use nu here. That's all right. I can use lambda, I guess. E to the minus lambda c, lambda the alpha over gamma of alpha c bigger than 0. Okay, so we'll take the prior distribution of the precision to be gamma. Then, I'm going to ignore the constants, and anything and any part that doesn't depend on C will be absorbed into the constant. Conditional density for C given X will be this, which I wrote down here without the 1 over root 2 pi to the n. Right? And this part is from here. And then I put this part here without the constant. But I have this meaning if I multiply this by the Bragg constant, I get that. OK, so let's combine the things as we mentioned. So remember sigma hat squared? What is this? Okay. So this part here is n times sigma hat squared. Okay, now how do we get the right constant? We take this thing to that power, goes here, and then gamma of this thing. So that becomes n sigma hat squared over 2 plus lambda to this power, n over 2 plus alpha, and then gamma of this power here. That's the posterior distribution, becomes a gamma. And what about the parameters in the prior? How much influence do they have in the posterior? Well, here we have, this term is quite a bit bigger than that. This is what the data give you. So the n times that is giving a heavy influence on the data compared to the prior parameter lambda. Here we have n over 2. That's going to swamp the prior parameter alpha. And up here, this is going to be playing a much larger role than that. And this will be playing a larger role than that. So the initial assumption kind of becomes washed out with the large sample. Okay, but the nice thing about choosing this is the prior, the posterior has the same form. Okay. And it was easy to derive. Okay, well, that was case two. Case three, what do you think case three is?
Both unknown.
Let's skip that. More, you can read it in the book. I think we've done enough completing the square and such like. Let's go on to efficiency. Is there a question about this? No? Okay. So let me do an example first. And this is from a series of examples in the text. You have some substance here, and it's emitting particles. And the particles come out in random directions. So let me draw coordinate axes here. And the particle comes shooting out in a random direction, theta. And if I put x equal to the cosine of theta, what are the possible values for x? Well, this thing could be shooting out in any direction. That means theta could be anywhere from 0 to 2 pi, and that means x could be anywhere between minus 1 and 1. And from experiments, it's determined that the density for x, for the cosine of this random angle, depends on a parameter alpha. And given alpha, the density has this form. Okay, yeah?
So are x and theta random variables?
Or so theta would be some random. So think of theta as a random variable. X is cosine of that random variable.
Is there a reason we're not using capital letters?
Okay. Good question. So I guess I had in mind one realization, like we did observe one, and then it would be a little theta. So generally, if you see a capital letter, that means you haven't seen anything yet. And if it's a small letter, something has been observed. And when we go from random variable to small letter to observations, we go from capital to small. OK, so the goal is to estimate alpha given data. So let's do the moment of method of moments estimator first. So we need to compute the moment of a random variable with this parameter. So we just multiply x times the density here. And and what do we get from this one? We get 0, right, because it's an even function. From this one, we get x cubed over 3 evaluated from minus 1 to 1. And at 1, it's a third. At minus 1, it's minus a third. So we get 2/3. So this should be alpha over 3. So mu is alpha over 3. So the moment of methods estimator, you replace mu by x bar. So maybe I'll call this alpha tilde. Okay. Now, what about the MLE? Here we write down the likelihood function given some data. Log of that ratio is log of this minus log 2. If I add up log 2 n times, I get that. Now we have to compute, find the place where this is maximized. So we take derivative and set it equal to 0. When we take the derivative here, we get the sum I equal 1 to n. Derivative of that with respect to alpha would give you an xi over 1 plus alpha xi. So the alpha hat here, alpha hat satisfies the equation. Sum, we'll express it now in terms of random variables, I equal 1 to n capital Xi over 1 plus alpha hat Xi is equal to 0. And we can't really solve this. But we know it's there. There is some number alpha hat that does that. And that's our likelihood estimator. OK. They don't look like they're the same at all, alpha hat and alpha tilde. So that leaves the problem of which one do you use? Which one should we use?
MLE.
Okay. All right, maybe that's a good idea. Which one should we use? Well, how would you decide? What are usually when you're buying things, you pick one over the other because the one you picked is better than the one you didn't pick, in some sense, right? So we'd want to know which one is better. And how do we decide what's better when it comes to estimators? Right, which the one that has the smallest variance is better, right? Or the, yeah, or so, but, so what we want to compare let's see, I want to get these in the right order because well, look at this. This is called the efficiency of alpha hat relative to alpha tilde. Now, when would we choose alpha hat? If we could compute these two numbers, when would we choose this one over that one? Well, when this is smaller than that, and that would mean when this is bigger than 1. So if this is bigger than 1, we choose the denominator. If this is less than 1, we choose the numerator. If it's equal to 1, we do what? Oh, no, we toss a coin. Come on. Okay, so that's efficiency. And in order to increase the drama in the class, I'll say we'll take a break. Okay, so to repeat, if this is bigger than 1, then we use alpha hat. If it's less than 1, we use alpha tilde. Okay. So that means we should compute the variances for these two estimators. Well, the variance for alpha tilde would be 9 times the variance of x bar. X bar is formed from an IID sample of x's. So it's that the sum of the variances is sum variance of the variance of the sum is the sum of the variances. So we get the variance of x1 n times, but remember in x bar there's a 1 over n that gets squared, so it comes out 1 over n squared and then n of these. So we have to compute variance of x1. And we just did this a few minutes ago, and that turned out to be alpha over 3. So this would become alpha squared over 9. And so we have to compute the expected value of x1 squared when x1 has this density. And this time, this integral is 0. So we get integral of x squared, that'd be x cubed over 3. So I think it's 1/3. But then I have a half. So I think that's 1/3. And so the variance of x1 would be 1/3 minus alpha squared over 9, or if I do it in terms of could write it this way, I guess. Okay.
Shouldn't it be 3 minus alpha squared over n?
Say it again.
3 minus alpha squared over n, since you have to multiply the term.
Oh, yeah. N goes here, right? And then times 9, right? So I have to put this in for this, right? So I have to multiply this by 9, so I get 3 minus alpha squared over n. Okay. This has to go here. This 9 is that 9. This 9 is this 9. This n is that n. Okay. So we get variance of alpha tilde is 3 minus alpha squared over n. Okay. Now I'll leave it as an exercise for you to compute the variance of alpha hat. Why would I do that? Because I don't know how to do it. Why don't I know how to do it? I don't know how to solve this even for alpha. Well, you could, I guess, maybe numerically. So how can we possibly get the variance of alpha hat? If you can't get your hands on it, how can you? Well, do we know anything about variances of MLE estimators?
No.
Oh, right, the central limit theorem. And remember, alpha hat is a non-biased estimator. Well, let's see. So, no, well, if, so the variance of alpha hat would be about like 1 over n I of alpha, where I of alpha is expected value of derivative with respect to alpha log f of capital X given alpha quantity squared. Okay, so asymptotically we know what the variance looks like. See, the variance of alpha is the same as the variance of alpha hat minus alpha. Why is that? I don't need bias here. Just because if you shift a random variable by a constant, it doesn't change its variance. If you add a constant to a random variable, that won't change its variance. It doesn't even have to be unbiased. Variance of alpha hat is the same as the variance of this. And the variance of this is asymptotic to this thing. So that means in the numerator here, we'll have 3 minus alpha squared over n. Here we'll have what? 1 over n times I of alpha. So in the end, this would be what? About like I of alpha times 3 minus alpha squared? Is that right? So we have to decide whether that's bigger than 1 or less than 1. Is that okay, everybody? this becomes 1 over n I of alpha. The numerator is this over n. The over n's cancel. And we'd have 3 minus alpha squared divided by 1 over I of alpha becomes that. So we need to compute this I of alpha. So let's compute the derivative of the log of the density first. There's the density. When I take the log, I get log 1 plus alpha x and then minus log 2. When we differentiate the log of, I'm sorry, this is respect to alpha here. The log 2 term goes away, so I just get the derivative of log 1 plus alpha x. Derivative of log is 1 over the thing inside, but then I have to multiply by the derivative of this with respect to alpha, which would be x. Okay. Okay, so that's what I of alpha is. Here's the derivative of the log of f with respect to alpha squared and times the density dx, which is saw this on a test, you'd probably have a flood of panic for a moment. But then you'd remember, I should divide 1 plus alpha x into x squared. You say, no, you shouldn't divide. This was from too long ago, right? Okay. Okay, what I have to multiply this by to get an x squared? Yeah. Now what do I have to multiply this by to get a minus x over alpha? And the remainder is 1 over alpha squared. Oh, so this is 1 over E, sorry. That's 1 over E. Okay, this table's in the book. So I just inverted what they had here. So down here, when alpha is 0.95, this thing would be 1 over 0.46, or bigger than 1. So you'd take alpha hat, the MLE would be better than the MME. When alpha gets small, the MME and MLE have a relative efficiency close to 1, so it's a bit of a toss-up which one you want to use. Why might you use alpha tilde instead of alpha hat?
It's a lot easier.
You can compute it, right? Yeah, you can compute it. Actually, you could compute alpha hat also, but it would take some effort. So there's going to be some balance between efficiency and ability to compute. So up in here, you'd probably take the MME, because they're almost the same efficiency. I'm sorry, yeah, method of moments estimator, because it's just X bar. Down here, you'd probably want to take the MLE, because it's much more efficient. And you don't mind the extra effort of computing it. Okay? Yeah, question?
When you do the relative difference, why did you multiply the denominator of 1 over alpha squared by that thing?
Isn't that how... Isn't that the remainder?
Yeah.
That's the remainder. And you, it's just like long division.
Wouldn't it be alpha x plus 1 times that thing on top of it plus 1?
Is that right? So it should be what?
Alpha x plus 1.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, you're right. It's not divided by, it's times. I thought it was, yeah. No. Well, let's see. What x squared over alpha x plus 1 should be x over alpha minus 1 over alpha squared plus something. Another way to do this is So what do we expect here? Should this be, you think it should be something times alpha x plus 1. What side? What would this side be then? A polynomial of degree 1. Is this a polynomial of degree 1? No. So what did I have? What was it, 1 over alpha squared? Let's recombine this and see what we get. The common denominator here would be alpha squared alpha x plus 1 from these three fractions. So we should multiply this by alpha times alpha x plus 1. We should multiply that by alpha x plus 1. And we should multiply this by, well, just 1, okay? Let's see what we get. What's the coefficient of x squared in the numerator? Here we get an alpha squared x squared. So it'd be alpha squared x squared, is that right?
Mm-hmm.
What's the coefficient of x? We get an alpha x minus alpha x, 0. What's the constant term? Minus 1 plus 1, so 0. Divided by alpha squared alpha x plus 1. Okay. Does that answer your question? Okay. I think I might have told this story before. My oldest son was really upset when I told him that the repeated decimal 9999 was 1. He said, "No way, they're not the same." And I said, "Well, what's the decimal for 1/3? What's the decimal expansion for 1/3?" He said, 0.3333. So I said, "You're okay with that?" He said, "Yeah." I said, okay, now multiply both sides by 3. He said, no, it can't be right. So that is what you looked like. I showed it to you, and you were a little bit unhappy. Okay, so just like purchasing things, you know, you could buy a Toyota Fit or a Lamborghini. Which is better?
Toyota.
Lamborghini. But there's a question of cost, right? And that's what it's like here. There's a question of cost. There's a cost to calculating alpha hat. So the cost has to somehow be outweighed by the benefit. Okay. And same way here. If you're not going to gain much in efficiency, you'll probably take the MME. If you're going to gain a lot in efficiency, you'll take the MLE. Okay. All right. Okay, so let's redo an example that I did before. I think we did the MLE for lambda and Poisson. Here we have the okay. Lambda is some unknown. And L of lambda then is the log of that. Okay, and so L prime of lambda would be n x bar over lambda minus n. When is this 0? When x bar is lambda. So given random variables x1 through xn, which are Poisson parameter lambda, lambda hat, the MLE, is x bar. In terms of efficiency, can we do better? Is there another estimator for lambda that has a smaller variance? It's hard to say. Unless you know the Kramer-Rao theorem. Thank you. Let me be careful here. Yeah. Let me reword this. Okay, provided the density f x given alpha of the axis is smooth enough. In other words, no matter how you estimate, if you have an unbiased estimator, the variance of that estimator can't be smaller than this. And remember I of alpha?
What is T?
There are two ways to compute I. It's either you take the derivative of the likelihood of this thing and square it and take the expected value, or you take second derivative, multiply by minus sign, and take expected value. So how can we decide that question up there? Our x bar is a function of the data, right? Is that x bar, is that function of the data unbiased? What's the expected value of x bar for Poisson? What's the expected value of a Poisson random variable with parameter lambda? So the probability of x bar would also be lambda. So that's an unbiased estimator. So we could apply this theorem. What's the variance of our estimator there? Well, what's the variance of a Poisson random variable? Lambda. So the variance of x bar would be lambda over n. How can we tell if we can do better? Well, we better compute I for the Poisson. What's I for the Poisson? Okay, so there's the Poisson density. What's f of x log f of x given lambda is x log lambda minus log x factorial, right? Do you agree with this? And so we differentiate once with respect to lambda. We get x over lambda minus 1. We differentiate one more time with respect to lambda. We get minus x over lambda squared. So we have to evaluate this at capital X, which is a Poisson random variable, take the expected value of this, and then multiply by minus sign. But there's a minus sign here, and there's a minus sign there, so it becomes plus. There's a 1 over lambda squared. That's a constant. I can pull that out. So I'm going to convert this minus sign to a bar. And we get that. Okay, and expected value of x is lambda, so I of lambda is 1 over lambda. So what's the lower bound we get? 1 over n I of lambda is lambda over n. So can we do better? No, can't do any better than the Kramer-Rao lower bound. And this achieves the Kramer-Rao lower bound. It's equal to the Kramer-Rao lower bound of 1 over n I of lambda. And so there is no more efficient estimator of lambda than x bar. You can't find an estimator with smaller variance. Okay. Okay, so that's the idea of efficiency. I'll leave it to you to check efficiency for other things. I think there are some exercises that ask about that. There's also the notion of sufficiency. When we're doing estimates of things like, well, normal, when we're doing estimates of the mean or the variance or in other things like Poisson or binomial, when we're trying to estimate parameters, we take observations and we form some function of those observations and then use that function to estimate the parameter. So what we're doing is we're taking a lot of information, like a data set, which might have 1,000, 2,000, 10,000, 50,000 numbers, and we're collapsing it all down to one number, and then we're using that to estimate a parameter. So we take a lot of information, and we collapse it down to one little piece of information, and you might ask, well, is there more information in the data set to be used that might help in estimating the parameter? Have I lost some information? Can I get more out of the data than I have by forming this statistic I formed? And if you can't get more information, then the statistic is called sufficient. And here's the definition. So you have a random sample, x1 through xn, and you form some function of it. Okay, so it seems. That's saying that all the theta information, all the information about theta that's contained in this set is gone if you know, given the value of that statistic. So that if the conditional distribution did depend on theta, that means there would still be some more theta dependence of the data set. But this says there's in the statistics of the data set, there's no theta dependence once you know this value. Okay, which means there's nothing left, no trace of theta left. That's called sufficiency. So what's an example? Let's compute this. This is what we have to check. Does this depend on lambda? So I've just written down what the conditional probability is. Now this probability will be zero unless lx1 plus lx2 plus dot 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 plus lxn is n times t, correct? Because the last condition in the numerator says that the sum of the x's must be nt, and there we have the x's. If they don't add up to nt, that can't happen. So let's assume, that x1, and if it's zero, does that depend on theta? Do you see any theta in here?
No.
You have to look really hard to see it, but there's no theta there, right? So assume x1 plus x2 plus dot dot plus xn is n times t. All right. Now, if that's true, do we need the condition that the sum of the x's is nt?
No.
Right? Because it's redundant, right? And these are IID, so this would be lambda to the sum from 1 to n of little xi's over the product 1 to n of the xi factorial, and then e to the minus n lambda. Okay? That's the numerator. The denominator. And what's the sum of the xi's now?
Nt.
So we could rewrite this as lambda to the nt over product of the xi's factorial, and then e to the minus n lambda. Now let's compute the probability of the denominator. If you have two independent Poisson random variables, what's the distribution of their sum?
Poisson.
Pr- Poisson, where the parameter is what? The sum of the parameters. So if we add up n of them, we get a Poisson, and they all have parameter lambda, then it'd be Poisson parameter n lambda. So sum from 1 to n capital Xi is has a distribution which is Poisson with parameter n lambda. Therefore, the probability that the sum from 1 to n of the Xi's is nt would be n lambda to the nt over what? Nt factorial e to the minus n lambda, the parameter, right? The parameter, e to the minus parameter equals here. Okay, so we'd make the division now. The probability that capital X1 equal little x1 up to capital Xn equal little xn, given that the sum is nt, would be what? We have that term there, and we divide by this term. We get minus n lambda divided by this thing. Well, lambda to nt here and lambda to nt there cancel. E to the minus n lambda, e minus n lambda cancel. And in the end, you get nt factorial over n to the n product from 1 to n xi factorial. That's it. And no lambda. No lambda. All the information about lambda has been washed away by conditioning on the value of the statistic. So that says that x bar is a sufficient statistic for lambda. One last one. I can do this in 1 minute and 25 seconds. Okay, now the little x's here are going to be zeros and ones because the Bernoulli random variables are zero or one. So, we get this ratio. Oh, thank you. Let's assume these add up to nj, because if they don't, the numerator has probability, or the probability in the numerator is zero, okay? And there's no evidence of theta in zero. And now, if we do assume that, this is redundant, because these automatically add up to having x bar equal to j, right? This should be j down here, too, sorry. Okay, now, what do we get in the numerator? That's the probability of a particular sequence of ones and zeros happening. It'd be theta to the number of ones, and then 1 minus theta to the number of 0. So that'd be theta to the number of 1s would just be the sum of the xi's. 1 minus theta to the number of 0s, that'd be the sum 1 minus xi's. Right? Xi's are 1 or 0. This would be the number of 1s. You get that many successes and this many failures. That's the numerator. The denominator, that just says we have to have n times j successes in n Bernoulli trials. Or, we have to have, n times j successes in n Bernoulli trials. So that'd be n choose nj. And then we'd have to have nj successes in 1 minus nj failures. And now what's the sum of the xi's? Nj, right? So we have theta here to what power? Nj, and theta here to the nj. And what would this be? This would be n minus, this should be n here. N minus the number of failures would be, they're n trials, you subtract the number of successes. Here we have n when we add that up, and then when we add up these, we get nj. So this becomes n minus nj. That's n minus nj. So both things that depend on theta cancel. You get 1 over n choose n times j. No theta. So x bar is also a sufficient statistic for the probability of success in independent Bernoulli trials. And we'll do some more examples and next time.